Merry Christmas, everybody.
They told me pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, a newborn king to see, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Our finest gifts we bring, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, to lay before the king. So to honor him, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, when we come. For you, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum, on my
Good evening. Merry Christmas, everybody. We are thrilled you are here. I am Scott. I'm the lead pastor here. We're thrilled that you chose to be here for Christmas Eve service at Fairfield Christian Church. Just want to take a moment to welcome you. We got a little bit of everything tonight. We got a little bit of our children are going to do something. We're going to celebrate the birth of Jesus, and we're going to do it our way, and it's going to be an awesome night. Thank you for being here. I want to pray, but before we do that, why don't you stand up, take a moment, and say hi to somebody. Merry Christmas. Wish them a Merry Christmas. That's enough friendliness. Okay. That's it. You can go ahead and have a seat for just a second. Oh, I'm kidding. We are thrilled you're here. If you're a guest especially, thank you for being here. We hope you join us for one of our regular services. But we've got some special things for you tonight. Most importantly, we're going to celebrate the birth of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. So would you join me in prayer, and then we're going to get ready and do a little bit of worship. God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for the gift of Jesus. We thank you for all the things that you do for us that we could never do for ourselves. God, tonight we celebrate Christmas. We celebrate the birth of the Savior of the world, the reason that we have hope, the reason we can have joy, the reason our life has purpose. Thank you for Christmas. Thank you for Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. All right, would you stand to your feet and join the band?
Gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember, Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy.
Seated. Once again, we're so glad you guys came to worship and celebrate Christmas this evening with us. We're now going to enjoy a time of a nice fun skit that we're going to have by our Kids Quest group as they're setting up here. So who is excited for Christmas? Yeah? Am I right? Who's excited for just the new year? Anybody excited for the new year? Kind of? Okay, yeah. 2024 would be a fun time there. So we'll let them get set up here in place, and then please enjoy one of our skits here.
I can't wait. I'm so excited.
Well, it looks like we have almost everything we need to celebrate.
Cookies, carols, lights, all types of decorations.
A big, beautiful Christmas tree. And, of course, lots of presents.
I love presents.
Me too.
But so hard to wait to open them.
Oh, it's almost time. We better finish getting ready.
Did you guys hear that?
Christmas is almost here.
Hooray!
It's our favorite time of year!
Yeah.
It's going to be so sweet!
Just like us.
But did you hear what they said?
They said they were really excited about us.
Well, of course they are. You can't have Christmas without presents.
You certainly can't. Everybody has to have presents at Christmas.
Imagine waking up on Christmas morning and not finding me.
Well, what about us? But what about us? Just imagine Christmas without us.
Yeah, without Christmas lights, nothing would shine, twinkle, blink, or beam.
You can't have Christmas without Christmas lights.
You can't have Christmas without us either.
Yeah.
I mean, what would Christmas taste like if the special taste of Christmas were beans and broccoli?
Ew.
Hey, I like broccoli.
Me too. And you know, Christmas just wouldn't be the same without us.
No stockings by the fireplace.
No wreaths hanging in the windows.
No giant inflatable lawn decorations.
Without decorations, it just wouldn't be Christmas.
Well, at least you can't have Christmas without one very important decoration. Me. I'm talking about me. Where would you put the presents? Where would you hang the tinsel and the lights? Nope, without me, Christmas just wouldn't be the same.
Don't forget about us. Oh, Christmas tree, imagine Christmas without carols, as if. Christmas is literally about us. Me, 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 me. You can't have Christmas without carols.
You can have Christmas without carols. No, absolutely not. The tree is what makes Christmas.
Lights make everything shine.
No, absolutely not.
Hey, what's going on in here?
Nope.
Stop! Are you all fighting about who's the most important part of Christmas?
Presents are.
The lights.
Cookies.
Decorations.
The Christmas tree, of course. What's that?
This, you can't have Christmas without this.
What are those?
This is Christmas.
This is Mary and Joseph. God told Mary she was going to have a baby. She was going to have her baby in a little town called Bethlehem.
There were a lot of people in town, so there wasn't room for them in any inn. Shepherds, a great choir of angels came to them, announcing Jesus' arrival to all people.
There was a star shining high in the sky. It led the Magi to find him. They brought him gifts of great worth and great sacrifice.
And
and this is Jesus. God sent him to live with us, to teach us how to love like he would love.
You can't have Christmas without Jesus.
If that is Christmas, then what are we all doing here?
I guess we're not needed.
Come on, friends, let's go.
Now wait a minute, don't go.
Christmas won't be the same without all of you.
Really?
Of course not.
The truth is, we don't need cookies, carols, lights, decorations, Christmas trees, and presents. We don't need all that, but we do want you.
We want you, lights, to remind us that Jesus is the light of the world.
We want you, decorations, to deck every hall, everywhere, to remind us that Jesus is all around us.
Carols. Sing to us like the angels sang out Jesus' arrival to all people.
Cookies. You will remind us how sweet are the mercy and promises of God.
Christmas tree. You need to remind us of the life that Jesus gave for us on a tree.
And presents. You will remind us how sweet... Remind us of the great gift of love God gave to all when he gave us Jesus.
So you really do want us to stay?
Of course we do.
All of us?
Every single one of you.
Christmas wouldn't be the same without all of us.
That's right, and now you can all help us to remember...
You can't have Christmas without Jesus.
Merry Christmas!
Stand and sing and worship with us here.
He gave his only son.
Cry as we celebrate this Christmas season and celebrate the birth of your Son. That you alone are worthy of the praise. Father, we thank you for what you've done. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing in our lives, Lord. As we enter into a time of a new year, we thank you for what you're going to do, Lord. We just trust you that you will provide, you will guide, and you will sustain. We just thank you so much. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen and amen. You all may be seated.
Spirits by thine And death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O
Well, thank you again for being here for our Christmas Eve service. We are thrilled to have you here. If you're a guest, thank you so much for joining us as family tonight as we celebrate. We do hope that you'll come back and join us for one of our regular services. By a quick show of hands, how many of you have already started opening your Christmas presents? Okay, now how many of you just confessed to your family that you just opened your Christmas present? No, I'm just kidding, I'm kidding. No, many of us already started it. We opened up presents this morning, right? How many of you, when you open up those presents, I'm curious, how many of you do that, oh, I know what this is? How many of you do that? My family better raise their hands wherever they are, right? Now, my wife is guilty of this all the time. She doesn't like to be surprised. She knows it, but usually she goes shopping with her mom, so she already knows what she's getting. My daughter does the same thing, right? And it's one of the things, I know what I'm getting. But, I mean, it kind of ruins a little bit of the surprise. Anybody in here ever gotten an absolutely horrible gift? Don't look at the person. Don't, okay? Yeah, I did. The year was 2001. My wife was my fiance at the time. We had gotten engaged in December. I drove from Maryland to Ohio to visit her family. And it was Christmas time, of course. And I went over to her grandparents' house. Grandma and grandpa was awesome. And, you know, I didn't really go in expecting any gifts because, I mean, I wasn't really part of the family. I was on probation at the time. And But I get to Grandma and Grandpa's house, and I realize that gifts are a big deal to my wife's family, and we're sitting there around, and Grandma comes over, and she pops this big, giant, heavy gift in my lap. I'm like, man, I didn't expect anything. This is awesome. And I began to watch, and of course, in her family, they go youngest to oldest, and they begin to open up presents, and everyone they open up is like, awesome and amazing, and I'm like, oh, this is gonna be sweet, right? I am 22 years old. Grandma and grandpa are gonna take care of me. They love me. This is awesome. What are they gonna give to the fiance of their favorite grandchild? That's true. You can ask her. She was the favorite. Man, I get excited. It comes back to my turn, and I begin to peel off the, you know, when you're first with a family, you don't really show your true, like, way you open presents. You do it all nice. And I begin to peel it open, and I'm getting excited because the box is heavy. I'm like, man, this is going to be awesome. I don't know what I was thinking, man. I open it up, man, 22 years old. This is towels. I don't know many 22-year-old single guys that are excited about matching towels. My loving wife, fiance at the time, she leans over to me and she whispers, just smile and say thank you. I was like, well, that's good, because there were some other words I was going to say. So I did. But in reality, I think we used those towels for years in our marriage. So it worked out. But I went from not expecting a gift at all to being disappointed in the gift I got, which is just weird. Now, look, I'm not the best gift giver, but here's what I'm going to tell you. If you've given somebody towels for Christmas and it wasn't on their list, you didn't give them a good gift. Okay, I'm just going to let you know that you're that person. But it got me thinking, what does make a good gift? Like, they didn't know me. They didn't know who I was. It was the first time I'd ever went to their house. Right? We all have different styles. We all have different flavors, different interests. What makes a good gift? Well, according to the New York Times, a good gift is more focused on long-term enjoyment, something that you can really enjoy for a long time. The commercials will tell you it's apparently diamond rings or a Lexus. But it's something you can enjoy for a long time, not something that has a short-term flair. New York Times also tells us that it's something that the recipient would enjoy. There is nothing worse than getting a gift that somebody else is going to enjoy. For years, I was the guy that got the crock pot at Christmas for our family, and it was always labeled to Scott and Andrea because I would run out of gifts first. And since she was the favorite, she would run out last. According to Hallmark, which we know is all about gifts and one-plot movies, in their research, they found that a gift that becomes a great gift, I mean, the gift that just makes Christmas, has a couple things in it. One, it goes beyond the gift itself to become an experience. Two, it captures a specific and important time in somebody's life. See? It reflects personal aspects of you or the connection the two of you have. You give that gift because it's a reflection of the connection you have. And the last thing is that it shows that the person that you gave that gift to, that you really get them and that you know what matters to them. See, a perfect gift is not about the price. In fact, they said you can re-gift things if it matters. It's not even about the item, but it has to show that you understand and you connect with the person on a deeper level. Think about the good gifts you've gotten. Is that true? For the most part. In a physical sense, a good gift for one person might not be the great gift for another. Listen, in my life, in a string of three straight gift-giving opportunities for my wife, I gave her a steam mop, an Amish broom, and a treadmill. Now, you see, right? Some of the ladies are like, I will kill you. Right? But here's the deal. Here's the deal. My wife was tickled because that's what she wanted. It shows I got her. I understood her. Right? I didn't tell anybody that that's what I got her. But we have this connection. But I often struggle with giving gifts. I love giving gifts, but I don't always give good gifts. And we know at Christmas time it can be challenging. And so as I began to think about Christmas, it really hit me that God never has to worry about giving good gifts, giving the perfect gift. God never had to worry about it. See, God is perfect, and when God gives gifts, He doesn't have to worry about giving a gift that isn't perfect. God doesn't get the size wrong. He doesn't pick out the wrong color. He doesn't get you something you already have. God doesn't have to worry about the perfect gift. God gave us the perfect gift, and that's why we celebrate Christmas. In fact, James, the brother of Jesus, reminded us why God doesn't worry about it. In James 1, he says, "Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights." I want you to remember that phrase here in just a second. "Who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth." We know that to be Jesus. "That we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created." Every good and perfect gift comes from above. Gifts are awesome. It's got to be the best thing about Christmas outside of Jesus, right? You ever went to a Christmas party and nobody got a gift and you're like, this is lame. We could have done this in July. I love giving gifts. I love receiving gifts. And usually you got that one gift that makes your Christmas. In fact, we ask our kids that. We go, hey, what's that one gift that if it shows up on Christmas Day, you're like, oh, and they tell you. And then you go, ha, try again. But for some of us, it's something we really want or something we really need. I mean, You ever get a Christmas gift that you need? Like you got something? I'm not talking about socks and underwear. I'm talking about like a Christmas gift that you really needed. See, when James talks about the good and perfect things from heaven, when he talks about the good and perfect gift coming from God above, he's only talking about one thing. He's talking about Jesus. And this is a guy who knew him because he was his brother. See, God doesn't change. He is not like a shifting shadow. The greatest gift he could ever give us is one that would bring us back into relationship with him. He picked the perfect gift for us. He came with a purpose, with a plan, with a mission to bring humanity back to God. And this is the best part of the gift, because the greatest gift solves the greatest problem. The greatest problem in the world was solved on that very first Christmas day. When Jesus stepped off his throne in heaven to come to this earth as a human baby, born of the Virgin Mary, life changed for all of humanity. And so I want to take you to that very first Christmas today. Just really quickly, it's in Luke chapter 2. Many of us are familiar with it. But as we read this story, I want you to pay attention to it, because it's become so familiar to us that maybe we don't pay attention to it. I want you to pay attention to how Jesus was announced that very first Christmas morning. Luke 2, we're going to start with verse 4. It says, "So Jesus also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone round them." Remember, we talked about James said he was the father of the heavenly lights. And they were terrified. But the angel said, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." Listen, this was no ordinary birth. We know what happened. See, while Joseph and Mary were in Bethlehem, Mary gave birth to Jesus. She wraps him up and she places him in a manger, and that's what happened. But the announcement about what happened is way bigger. It's way bigger than that. The shepherds out in the field are the first to find out about this miraculous baby that we celebrate on Christmas. Now, remember, James said God was the father of lights, and when the angel of the Lord shows up, the shepherds say it was the glow of the Lord that shone round about them. I believe this was absolutely a beautiful, bright picture. And what does the angel tell the shepherds about Jesus? First, hey, this baby is going to bring great joy to all people. And they proceed to describe Jesus as Savior of the world, as the Messiah, the Lord. Jesus was the one the Old Testament spoke of. Jesus was the one who was sent to earth to restore humanity to himself. He solved the greatest problem. How could man be in relationship with God? Jesus, the Son of God, stepped out of heaven on that very first Christmas. Because he loves us. Humanity itself had created this divide through sin. And the only way to solve that problem was through a perfect sacrifice. We caused it. We sin. He solved it. God gave his son to save the world from itself. This image right here. This image of a manger. And a cross. This is the perfect gift. It isn't a gift we deserved, but Jesus came anyway. It wasn't a gift we asked for, but Jesus came anyway. When the Son of God stepped out of heaven to come to this earth, He did it with a purpose. And that purpose was to save the world from itself. And that promise is as true this Christmas as it was that very first night in Bethlehem. And tonight we're reminded at our Christmas Eve service that Jesus came to this world as a baby. But he left this world as the sacrificial Lamb of God that paid the price for your sin and for mine. And what better way to spend this Christmas than to start living a life with Jesus? And so if you're here tonight, I simply get the privilege of standing up here to tell you that the baby we celebrate at Christmas grew up. He lived a perfect life, one devoid of sin but not of temptation. And he willingly went to the cross to pay the penalty. The only accepted payment for the sins of the world was the shedding of blood of a perfect sacrifice. You and I cannot do it for ourselves. And that baby Jesus that came into the world, humble and meek, he went to the cross. He took the beatings. He took the pain. He took the punishment for the sins of the world, your sins and my sins. Why on earth would he do that? Because he loves you. Because he wanted to give you the perfect gift. And he is still in the business of offering the perfect gift. The gift of Jesus will solve your greatest problem. Where will you spend eternity? The Bible tells us that Jesus is the only way to heaven. And not only with Jesus do you get an eternity with God, he will walk with you daily and help you live a life that is designed by God for you. So as we celebrate the birth of Jesus, we celebrate because he offers this gift for anyone who's willing to accept it. And so if you're hearing me today and God's pulling on you, maybe you were invited to church by a friend, maybe you were invited to a Christmas Eve service because you knew it was going to be good and it was going to be exciting and we were going to do some really, really cool things. But if you were invited, he is offering this gift to you today. I will tell you, it does not matter what's under your tree, what you're getting from your in-laws, what you have given your wife. It doesn't matter. This is the greatest gift because it is the perfect gift for you. And so if you're hearing me today and God's pulling on you, I want to help you accept this gift today. God doesn't make it complicated. All you got to do today is first admit that you need God. I don't think any of us would say we're perfect. God doesn't make it complicated that you know you've fallen short of his standard of perfection and that you sin like the rest of us. Listen, if you can admit that, then it's really simple. You simply believe that what the Bible says is true. That Jesus came to this earth on that first Christmas morning, lived a perfect life, and went to the cross of Calvary, carrying the weight of your sin and mine with him, shedding his blood on the cross to pay the price, to be the ultimate sacrifice, to be the perfect gift for you. Why would he do that? Because he loves you that much. He loves you so much. And the Bible simply tells us that if you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart that Jesus died on the cross, was buried, and 3 days later rose from the grave, that you will be saved. There's no tricks. There's no contracts you got to sign. You don't have to give any money. And so today, I want to extend this invitation. And so I'm just going to ask you right where you are, just go ahead and bow your head and close your eyes for me, if everybody will do that. Listen, if you're in here and you have a relationship with Jesus, if you brought somebody with you that maybe doesn't, I want you to pray. Pray that God might speak to those who don't have a relationship with him. And today I want to ask, with heads bowed and eyes closed, if you're here tonight and for the first time you can say, you know what? I need Jesus in my life. You may have come tonight to celebrate Christmas, but now you are ready to experience the Savior. If that's you tonight, I'm just going to ask you to simply just lift a hand. I promise I won't embarrass you. Just put your hand up and let me see it. Just raise that hand. Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. There is nothing magical about these words. This is simply a conversation you have in your heart with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. If you've never accepted the gift of Jesus and you want to tonight, you can pray something simply like this. Say, God, I know I am falling short of your standard, that I am a sinner in need of a Savior. And God, I believe that Jesus came to this earth as a baby but went to the cross for me. I'm asking you to come into my life and save me. Be my Lord and Savior. Everybody keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed. Listen, tonight, if you prayed that prayer for the very first time, I'm going to ask you, just lift your head and look at me for a second. Just lift your head and look at me. You are now part of the family of God. And part of that responsibility is for you not to keep it to yourself. Tell somebody. Welcome to the family. The Bible tells us that the angels in heaven are doing backflips and they are so excited because you have joined the family of God. So tonight, before you leave, just take a moment. Come find me. Come find an elder. Come find a prayer team member. Tell the people that you came with, whatever it may be, so that you can tell somebody, tonight, I accepted the perfect gift. We want to celebrate with you. This is why Christmas is special. This is why Jesus came, to give you the perfect gift. God, tonight, we come to you thankful. Thankful for another year. Thankful for the gift that came to this earth, Jesus, as a baby that very first Christmas. God, tonight we celebrate those who stepped out in faith to begin that relationship with you. I know heaven is throwing a party right now because you've added new members to your family. God, we love you. We worship you. Just like the shepherds did that first silent night. Thank you for the perfect gift of Jesus.
Amen, amen. We're now coming to the time of our service that's kind of like a tradition of finding out. As you know, my family and I were new to the FCC tradition, but we're really excited to partake of this with you guys. So we, it's coming to the time where we're going to, everybody got their candle when they came in, correct? All right. I'm going to challenge you all to go ahead and stand up, but we're going to show you the proper way to light the candle, just so we don't have to claim an insurance claim this week. So yes, as you'll see, we've got great examples right here. So if you have a lit candle, you're going to stay put. And then if you have a non-lit candle, you're going to come to the person with the lit candle, like so, light the wick of your candle, and then spread the joy to the person next to you. But hold it, but once you're always lit, you stay still and let the other people come to you. And while we do that, we are going to sing Silent Night together. I think we all know that one, but the words will be on the screens, so we can sing that together. So we will start.
Silent night, holy night. Perfect gift of Jesus. And it's amazing how light in the scripture is such a beautiful picture of God. As you go tonight into all your festivities and your parties and family and traveling and whatever it is, we pray you be safe. We pray you enjoy Christmas. And we pray most of all that you celebrate that baby in a manger, Jesus, who came to give you life. I want to invite you back. We're starting a new series in January called Encountering Hope, where we're going to see people who met Jesus. We'd love to have you here for our 9 o'clock hour called Next Level with Discipleship and 10:30 for our service right back here in this room. So before everybody gets too nervous and you start spilling wax everywhere, you can go ahead and put your candles down. You can blow them out, but don't be spitting wax on people. And we wish you a very Merry Christmas, safety, traveling, have a great new year. Merry Christmas from our church family to you. Go get your pictures, have some cookies, have a great night, and enjoy Christmas Day tomorrow together. Merry Christmas, everybody. Merry Christmas.